Good evening to all, and I welcome to all of you for this our session of heritage of interior design of ancient India. हमारे प्राचीन भारत का इंटीरियर डिज़ाइन किस तरह का था. हम लोग तो एक्सटीरियर डिज़ाइन जो है आउटसाइड जो है किस तरह से हुआ वगैरह वो सभी हम देखते हैं, बट हमारा इंटीरियर डिज़ाइन पर्टिकुलरली उसमें क्या टूल्स वगैरह यूज़ किए जाते थे, उसके लिए मटेरियल क्या यूज़ होता था, वो कैसे बनाया जाता था, उसका ओवरऑल व्यू जो है वो सब हम इसमें सीख रहे हैं. सो आज का हमारा सेशन अभी इसके बारे में जो है और डेप्थ में जानकारी हमें मिलेगी ऐसे हम उम्मीद करते हैं. और मैं सुचिता कामत मैडम से विनती करता हूँ कि कृपया अपने आज के सत्र की शुरुआत करें. जस्ट अ वेट मिनट प्लीज. यस मैडम, प्लीज अनम्यूट योर सेल्फ एंड स्टार्ट द सेशन.
यस सर, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी. सो वी स्टार्ट विद आवर कंक्लूडिंग सेशन. द लास्ट डे we have, and the last session we have the architect and his team binding and waterproofing materials, units of measurement, entrance doors, door frames and windows, significance of fragrances and their use in ancient Indian homes, guilds, mythological abodes. The architect and his team. A mythological descent of the artists is given in most of the architectural treatises. From the four faces of Brahma, the creator, originated the four heavenly architects, Vishwakarma, Maya, Tvastra, Manu. Their four sons are called respectively Stapati, Sutragrahi, Vardaki, Takshaka. These four formed a part of the guild of architects, each of an expert in his own department, consisting of the chief architect, the designer, the painter, the carpenter. The Sthapati was an equivalent to an architect in the present times. Sutragrahi took the measurements and was the subordinate of the Sthapati. The Vardaki was the artist and the painter, and the Takshaka was the carpenter. The Sthapati had to be proficient in all Vedas and Shastras. He was in command of all the architectural work, efficient in mathematics, astrology, proficient in painting, excellent draftsman and designer. His excellent knowledge of mathematics and astrology could be applied to the construction work. He was a man free from malice or spitefulness. Apart from Sthapatya and Vastu Shastra, he was a man well versed in music, being of noble descent. He had to have the virtues of being content, that is, not greedy, must be a truthful person, and must have self-control, and a man free from disease and disabilities. A good and famous Sthapati would be resourceful, devoted, and capable of applying knowledge to all works. So the Sthapati was the chief, the head architect of the ancient times, and everything was in his control, and he had to have these certain virtues, because if he didn't possess all these qualities, then that would affect his work. And following him, his subordinates would also take up the same ways. So his being an honest, truthful man with a lot of virtues was necessary. Sutragrahi also had to be proficient in the Vedas and the Shastras. He would be specialized in measurement, measuring and cutting, and an expert in drawing. For a Sutragrahi also, it was necessary to possess the knowledge of all the departments of Sthapatya Shastra and Vastu Shastra. Above all, he was expected to follow the instructions of the Sthapati. And the Sutragrahi was called so because he was the one who took the measurements. Like in this, you can see in the image, you can see this is a sutragrahi, and he is taking the measurement with the help of the sutra, which is a cord, a piece of thread, and these were of certain materials, like coir was used, that is a rope made from cotton husk was used, or threads, and they had specific markings also, and these were used like the measuring tapes of the present times. Also, one more thing, the sthapati would be either the teacher or the father of the sutragrahi, since the sutragrahi was exactly under the sthapati, so he should obey his master. And had he learned under somebody else, then it would be difficult for him to go well or coordinate with the sthapati. That is why the sutragrahi was generally either a son of the sthapati or a student of the sthapati, because this knowledge was not for a limited period of time. It was passed on from one generation to another, and the student also would stay with his master, with his teacher for a long time. So whatever the skills of his teacher, he would learn those. So that is why it was essential that the sutragrahi was somebody who was associated with the sthapati, so that they would have a good rapport. Vardhaki also had the knowledge of the Vedas and the Shastras, but he was specialized in painting. Like the sutragrahi, he also needed to have an idea of accurate measurements. He had to be capable of architectural designing and sculpture with his own imagination. The Takshaka, the carpenter and joiner, was an expert in carpentry and molding clay. So the Takshaka was the carpenter, and he also did the work of casting metal sculpture, because being a qualified and able man, he had the capability for application to his work. He had to follow the instructions of the sthapati, sutragrahi and vardhaki, but at the same time, being an independent decision maker was important, because each of these four people had very big responsibilities, and under them they had their individual teams, so they had to coordinate properly. And of these, the Vardhaki was the subordinate most, but his work also was very important, because the carpentry work and the cutting and the basic structure was the essence, the main factor of any, is even now we can say that it is the main factor, it is the foundation of any construction or any designing work. Vastu Shastra and Sthapatya. Shastra denotes all kinds of buildings, religious, which includes temples, residential dwellings and military forts, their auxiliary members, which are columns, walls, floors, ceilings, roofs, doors and other openings, and the component of molding and ornamentation. Secondly, it implies the town planning, laying out gardens, constructing marketplaces and ports, making furniture articles, which include bedsteads, couches, tables, chairs, thrones, wardrobes, baskets, conveyances, etc. So the conveyances also, the chariots and the carts, all these were also made by certain skilled people. So there were specialized personnel for each of these various aspects, and each one was very efficient in his work, and that is why the entire organization, and we can say the entire culture or the entire civilization, was well organized and well planned. Architecture also included sculpture and carving, because we see it on the carvings of the temples. The interiors as well as the exteriors have very beautiful carving. So that is why the architecture, and if the carving is done in such a way that it weakens the pillars or it weakens the columns, then that will become an architectural defect. So that is why it included sculpture and carving, and each person had to have that knowledge of the other fields. It was not that this is not my field of interest, so I will not know about it. It is better to know at least the basics of whatever we are dealing with. That even applies even today. Materials used. Sadly, we have lost a lot of knowledge and materials with time, use of new techniques and with modern technology. There were numerous cementing materials which were prepared with methods and formulas which we no longer know about. Because with time, all these the manuscripts, or even when it was the knowledge was passed by word of mouth. Because why by word of mouth? Because like these were secrets known to a particular line of these craftsmen and artists, and they would keep these secrets to their in their line, and that is why. That knowledge which was by way of word, when in later times when the people changed their professions, all this knowledge was lost, or even the manuscripts have been lost. There were numerous cementing materials which were prepared with methods and formulas which we no longer know about. Ancient Indian texts such as Brihat Samhita of Varaha Mihira and the Maya Mata of Maya Muni state and describe the materials and methods of cementing. These are in the chapters titled Vajralepa. Since Vajralepa is a type of glue, and glue means it's not just one type, there are various ways of making and different Vajralepas, and they have their applications also according to their composition. Binding materials, mortars and glues were used to fix idols and in wall constructions. Five such preparation methods with their respective ingredients are mentioned in the Chilpa Shastras. Now, of this, there is one interesting, which is waterproof lime mortar. Waterproof lime mortar was also prepared using a mixture of ghee, coconut water, black gram paste, that is ulad dal, extract from bark of the peepal tree, milk, curd, decoction of trifala, and pitcher, a type of gum, in prescribed proportion. All this was mixed with slaked lime, which in Hindi is chuna. Kankar was the lime, was the red lime in use. It was rich in iron. That is why that iron oxide imparted the color to this to the lime. Sudha was lime used for molds for sculpture, which is the metal sculptures. Because a metal sculpture has to be cast, and the for the casting a mold has to be prepared. So for this the lime called sudha was used. Mud, bricks, lime, stones, wood, metals and precious stones were used as building materials in ancient times. Bricks were known as ishtika, meaning giver of comfort and well-being. Since the word ishta means good, and bricks were of various shapes and sizes depending upon where they were used. The sage Angirasa has written about brick making. There were various types of roof tiles in use. Certain skills associated with these methods and techniques have been lost forever. At a later period, some experts deliberately changed profession due to the greedy, stingy lords and the people in power who underpaid the artists. It was not just this. If the finished product was not to their satisfaction, the poor craftsman would even lose his life. So if there was a person, some authority who was very cruel and was stingy, he would not pay the artist his due amount, and he would pay according to what he felt was correct, and the person had to work so hard, and in return he was just rebuked and he was scolded or even beaten, and sometimes even beaten to that extent that he would lose his life. So then that discouraged the artists from continuing these trades, and at a much later age, the value of these artists reduced, and these skilled workers lost their interest in their work because they were living in extreme poverty and they were facing such torturous situations that they felt discouraged to leave these professions and get into something else. So that is why, and since I mentioned before that these were there was a lineage of all these the trades of particular arts also. So all those were lost with one person, the last person stopping his work. The trade secrets would be lost. Poverty, suffering, and fear for life made a great impact on the skills and the skilled professions practiced by these gifted people. As a rule, materials like wood, stone, brick, etc., old, dilapidated, and destroyed buildings by fire, floods, etc., was not permitted to be used for constructing a new house or any other buildings. So natural calamities took their tolls on the buildings, and it was forbidden to use the wood or any other material from these damaged structures. Also, like in the previous session, I spoke about the type of wood, and some time before I have mentioned about the stones also. So like the material and testing of the material was very essential to build a well constructed and well structured place. Now we come to the units of measurement of the ancient times. The standard unit of ancient India was the angula. The Sulabha Sutra of the Bodhayana gives the specifications. Yojana is an ancient measure of distance, where one yojana roughly equals to 8 to 10 miles. Now the bifurcation and the basic, starting from the basic units, we begin with this. The units of measuring length and distance, I've just taken the distance and the lengths, not the weights and measures. An angula, which is three-fourths of an inch, equal to 34 sesame seeds kept touching each other. So that would make one angula, which is three-fourths of an inch. Four angula is equal to one dhanu-griha, that is... Dhanugraha is the grip with which a person holds the bow. So that was it was four angulas. Eight angulas, one dhanu mushti, fist with the thumb raised. Like this is a dhanu mushti, and this is a dhanugraha. Because the bow would be held in this, so that measurement is 8 angulas, and 12 angulas is equal to 1 vitaski, which is the distance between the tip of the thumb and the tip of the last finger. So from here to here, this span is the vitaski. 2 vitaskis is equal to 1 aratani, which is equal to 1 cubit. That is 18 inches or 45.72 centimeters. And it is the distance between the tip of the elbow to the tip of the little finger. 4 arantis is equal to 1 danda or 1 dhanusha, bow of height 6 feet. So the dhanushas were also of different heights. And a 6 feet bow height was equal to 4 arantis. 10 dandas is equal to 1 raju, which is equal to 60 feet. 2 rajus is equal to 1 paridisha, which is 120 feet. And 2000 dhanusha is equal to 1 krosha, or one posa or one course, also called Gorata, which is 4,000 yards, and 1 yard is equal to 3 feet. Hence, one krosha is 12,000 feet. It is 3,569 meters approximately. Four kroshas is equal to one yojana, as one yojana is 9 to 10 miles, that is 14,276 meters approximately. So this comes to, one yojana comes to about 14.27 or 28 kilometers. Chanakyan Arthashastra specifies two types of dhanushas. So, as I spoke before, the dhanushas were an ordinary dhanusha consisting of 96 angulas, the Garhapatya dhanusha consisting of 108 angulas, and 80,000 dhanushas measured 1 yojana. 8,000 dhanushas measured 1 yojana. I'm really sorry for the mistake. If we consider an angula to be 16.76 millimeters, then a dhanusha of 96 angulas is equal to 96 multiplied by 17.76 millimeters, which is 1.609 meters. So that comes to about 1.61 meters. A dhanusha of 108 angulas is equal to 108 into 16.76 millimeters, which is 1.812 meters. Since a yojana is 8,000 dhanushas, and the dhanusha being the 108 angula dhanusha, which is the Varapatya dhanusha, a yojana is equal to 8,000 into 1.810512 meters, which is 14.48 kilometers, which comes to 9 miles. Entrance doors and door frames. The beautiful main door. In Sanskrit language, the words dwara, pratihara, kavata are used for the English word door. Dwa and dwara are derived from the Sanskrit root dru, which means to receive. Thus, the door is an important furniture to receive a visitor. And since the inmates selectively admit the visitors inside, the word pratihara is used for the door. So, only the selected people are admitted, while the others are barred from entry, so it is known as pratihara, and they have to return. Kavata is used for the double shutter panel doors, and this is a single panel door. The entrance of any vastu speaks a lot about how the interior will be. The tradition of welcoming guests in our homes is an age-old practice. The main door in ancient times were elaborately carved and acted as a means of wealth display of the owner. Another reason could be the religious belief that at twilight, goddess Lakshmi enters a house through the main door. Thus, to please her and attract her to one's house, people started decorating the main door ornately. The main front door is called Simhadwar or the lion entrance. The woodwork of this was carved as elaborately as the financial capacity of the owner. There are two pieces laid across the top corners of the door, the door frame, which gives support to the lintel. I have not got the image of a Simhadwar, but these pieces would be here at this corner and this corner, because the top, that is the lintel, is placed on the frame, like on this, on these two posts. But even this gives additional support. If there is a bracket over here and here, it will give additional support to the lintel, which is placed on top. And above the lintel, is the wall. So the entire structure comes on the lintel and is supported by this cross bracket here, which will carry the, which will increase the area of the weight bearing, and it will conduct it downwards. There are two pieces laid across the top corners of the door frame, which gives support to the lintel. The lintel is a cross piece which supports the wall above. The lintel is laid on the carved wooden brackets. They are carved into a shape which represents lions, elephants, horses, or parrots according to the choice of the owner. So these are a few of the auspicious animal depictions, and the parrot also, which is a symbol of prosperity. So these are used on the door, on as the brackets of the door frame. The frame of a door is an essential feature, as the wall above a door opening rests on the frame. Likewise, as the door is fitted to the frame by the hinges, it bears the weight of the door. And the door also is a part of the load-bearing structure, and it is essential to have a very strong door frame. The height of the door was always twice its width. The door frames were called dwara shakhas. There were 1 to 9 sections of the door frames. The door frame was with one section was called Smarakirti. This type of frame was used for houses, so of the houses of the ordinary people had a frame with just one section. The door frame with two sections was called Samprabha. The door frame with three sections was called Shubhanga. This type of frame was used for the doors of the palaces of subsidiary kings. So I'll just come back, but these are the dwara shakhas. This is of a temple, and this is having just two shakhas. So going back to the text, because I couldn't get the image here, so I've put the images behind. The door frame with four sections was called Gandhari. The door frame with five sections was called Nandini. This type of frame was used for the doors on the palaces of emperors. So the looking at the door frame also, it is possible for us to understand where it was positioned and what was the status of the person whose house, or even if it was a temple, which deity it was, whether it was a Shiva temple or any other deity's temple. So that we can come to know from the dwara shakhas. The door frame with seven sections was called Hastini. This type of frame was used for the doors to the temples of all gods except Shiva. The door frame with eight sections was called Mukuli, and the frame with nine sections, Padmini. This type of frame was used for the doors to the temple of Shiva. A door frame was never complete without the threshold, because that the threshold, so with the threshold and the lintel and the side posts, it forms a frame, and this framework is necessary to keep the structure intact. If the threshold is not present, then the sides might just give in, or it might just get disfigured, or it might lose its shape. So the threshold was considered an important component of ancient construction. The section of the door opposite the Udambar was called Uttaranga, and the threshold was called Uttaranga, while the lintel was called the threshold was called the Udambar, and the lintel was called the Uttaranga. Uttaranga was wider than the Udumbar and had the following parts: Patra, Shakha, Maladhar, Rathika. And Uttaranga of temples had a carved image of the deity or the attendant of the deity who was housed in the temple. Like it was, it is here. So that is the Lalita Bimba. So the carving was at that point. For example, Vishnu temple would have a small image of Vishnu or Garuda. Later, the image of Ganesha on the Uttaranga became popular. The houses had Uttarangas with the images of Ganesha, the Vignaharta. Since Ganpati is worshipped by all, and he is a favorite of everyone, all of us, so he is depicted on the Uttaranga of the houses of ancient times. Even now, people put up tiles or little images of Ganesha on top of the door. Windows. The windows were as important as the doors. They were called Kampadwara, Gavaksha, or Vatayana. Windows were in all directions. As per the specifications mentioned in the Kashyap Shilpa, windows had two openable shutters and were 5 hastas wide. The lower section of the window frame was known as Bhuvanja, while the upper was called a Patanga. If the windows were of a temple, they used to provide only restricted amount of light. Then they had to have a carved screen. They had various names according to the carving done. The windows were named by the type of carving on the screen. It was called the Gavaksha if it had a screen with a design of circles like the eyes of a cow. The Nagbandha, a snake pattern. Valibandha, that is pattern of leaves. Kanjarakha, circles like the tiny eyes of the elephant. So these individual openings would be very small and would resemble the eyes of the elephant, and they were known as the Kanjarakha. Swastik or Pushpabandha are some other designs. So this has a Pushpabandha, it has flowers on it. Significance of fragrances and their use in ancient Indian homes. Fragrances induce their pleasantness to the interior spaces and help to change the mood. The various fragrances work on our senses and help in adding cheer to the people using a room. Ancient India was no exception to this. There was a perfume manufacturing industry which worked on scientific methods developed with a lot of research. The Sanskrit word Surabhi means perfume, fragrance, or sweet scent. The history of fragrance. We find mention of fragrance and perfume as Surabhi in the olden Indian epics and granthas. The kings would begin the day with fragrant water bath. According to the Agni Puran, they could take bath with over 150 varieties of fragrances. So the kings had a choice of more than 150 different fragrances with which they could bathe. They would add to their water and bathe with that water. Perfumes were manufactured in 8 phases and various forms like Gandha Tailam, Gandha Jalam, Kupana, Varna Kara Dravya, Mukhavasa were manufactured. So Mukhavas is a mouth freshener. Varnakara Dravya were the perfumes, the perfumes which were applied directly to the skin. And Dhupana was burnt. We still use dhoop in our houses. There are These are prescribed in a chapter in the Vishnu Dharmottar Puran, the 64th chapter of the second khanda. The Arthashastra of Chanakya gives descriptions of many fragrant drugs, as a large number of men and women were engaged in preparing fragrances, among whom the women numbered the most. These women were called Gandhakarika or Gandhabika. These fragrances were known as Gandha or Surabhi. Lamps were filled with fragrant oil, which were burned, filling the room with its pleasant smell. Fragrant powders were sprinkled on the bed sheets, and the floors were regularly sprinkled with perfumed water. Garlands of sweet-smelling flowers were hung to beautify the homes and to add fragrance to the rooms. Even today, especially on festive occasions, we put up toranas with flowers, fresh flowers, so that adds fragrance to the surrounding and gives a pleasant effect on everyone around. So that is how these people, and they used the garlands in the houses also. Unlike room fresheners, which we use the artificial ones, the natural fragrances are much better and they linger for a longer time. The earliest record of perfume making in India came to be found in the Brihat Samhita of Varaha Mihira, gives an account of perfume making in the 6th CE. All products used in ancient Indian perfumery were natural in origin. The aromatic substances were extracted from leaves, flowers, bark, roots, musk, camphor, etc. So here I would just like to give a little bit about personal information. My mother used to place champa flowers in her cupboard, and whenever it was opened, that fragrance lingered longer. Like perfumes which we use now, the artificial ones, don't last for that long, but these the fragrances of flowers, if they are kept, they keep the fragrance, the garment is kept fragrant for a longer time. Bills. From various inscriptions, a lot of information can be gathered about the professions in practice. Many guilds and professions were involved in the beautification of the architecture and also to aid the artists with the needed materials. The procedures were manually performed and involved a lot of hard work. Here we must consider the finished products, which were refined and long-lasting. Generations of craftsmen were involved in a particular craft. At times, the father, son, and also the grandson would be involved in carrying out the work, and they were established permanently at various places. Some of them migrated to other places, and so the practices spread from one region to another. Like the different styles of temple construction, so how they were evolved. So this is an example of it. How these things happened. Apart from the Sthapati and his team, there were various craftsmen skilled in numerous other professions related with construction and decoration. There were engravers, stone dressers, sculptors, icon makers, blacksmiths, goldsmiths, paint manufacturers, specialists in making weapons, tools and implements, carpenters, etc. The practices and skills were passed from one generation to the next by way of oral tradition. The Vishwakarma Puran says that Brahma and Vishwakarma together created the universe. So in the Puranas, there are various explanations to one phenomena, and that is attributed to whichever deity the Purana is about. So in the Vishwakarma Puran, it states that the five elements formed a large egg that burst with a thundering sound, and the universe was created. Shiva and Vishnu emerged from the blue space and created Brahma and Vishwakarma. Vishwakarma had five heads, that is five faces, three of smiths and two were of non-smiths. Now, which smiths? The Puranas also mentioned that the color of their faces was symbolic of their crafts. The golden face of the goldsmith, copper or brass for the coppersmith, black for the blacksmith. The non-smith heads were of the carpenter and the mason. So then, of course, for the carpenter had a wooden face, while the mason had a stone face. As soon as Vishwakarma was born, he made tongs out of the powers originating from Brahma and Vishnu. He joined the tongs with a nail called Rudram or Shiva and called it Kanka Mukha. In Sanskrit, it means tongs, an important tool for all smiths. Women were generally not involved, but if present, functioned in subordinate capacity in the work of the smiths. In the craft of blacksmith, they were allowed to work the bellow, but could not forge the metals. In the jewelry making, the women in the goldsmith's family, if permitted to work, were engaged in polishing, fine cutting, and making the designs more graceful and fine. But they were not allowed to design and make ornaments. And this was not about discrimination, but it was because the women had so many other chores to do, there they would get over in that. Now we have appliances, so we have a lot of spare time and we can work. We are fortunate about that. But in olden days, women had to do everything manually. So their time was occupied in doing all the works of the house. So, and if there was somebody who was interested, she would surely join in and help. Coming to abodes. Indra's abode Amravati was built by Indra himself. It is situated near Mount Udaya and glows with the radiance of the sun. It is 100 yojanas wide, 150 yojanas long and 5 yojanas high. Amravati is airborne and can travel anywhere as Indra desires. So it is a moving city, and it is on Indra's wish that it moves. It is laden with golden seeds and many celestial desire trees. In the middle of Indra's assembly hall, there is a large seat where Indra sits along with his consort Sachi. Now, what I would like to add in here is there is a lot of emphasis given on trees. Like, a lot of trees have been mentioned in the past sessions also. Whatever mythological cities or the palaces we have done, there are mentions of beautiful manicured gardens and a lot of trees planted. So that speaks about conservation of nature. The personified feminine forms of modesty, fame, and radiance always surrounded Indra at his abode. Indra's assembly hall is named Pushpakara Malini, situated on the eastern side of Mount Meru. It is said to have 1,000 gates and 100 palaces. So that speaks about how enormous it was. It is full of fragrant flowers and sacred trees, and with celestial chariots moving at will. It is the abode of celestial beings like Devas, Gandharvas, and others. Abode of Brahmadev. Its location is described as in Devi Bhagavata as follows. Brahma's world extends to over 10,000 yojanas on the Mahameru mountain. There are 8 cities, each 2,500 square yojanas in extent. The Ashtadikpalas in 8 parts of this Brahmapuri. There are 9 cities on the top of the Mahameru. They are as follows. In the center is Brahma city, Manovati. To the east of Manovati is Indra's city, Amravati. To the southeast corner, Agni city, Tejovati. On the southern side, Yama's city, Tamyamani. In the southwest corner, Nairuti city, Chananja. To the west, Varuna City, Shraddhavati. To the northwest corner, Vayu City, Gandhavati. To the north, Kubera City, Mahodaya. To the northeast corner, Shiva City, Yashovati. Brahma City of Manovati. So coming back after seeing where the various cities of the other deities were, we come back to Brahma City, Manovati. Brahma City, Manovati, which is also known as Brahmalok or Satyalok, is situated on the Meru Mountain. It is the highest among the 14 realms of the material worlds. Hunger, thirst, and all types of fatigue disappear as soon as someone enters Brahma's abode, which is filled with divine knowledge. The place is beautifully colored and supported by large white pillars. Brahma being the creator, his abode does not decay and remain eternal till the end of creation. Brahma's assembly hall shines with the radiance that surpasses the beauty of the sun and the moon. The beams of Brahma's abode signify the peak of the material world. In the middle of the assembly hall, Brahma sits in a grand lotus and constantly creates the beams through the power of his austerities. Brahma creates all entities of time, days and nights, months, years, yugas, kalpas, as well as all the seasons. There are large pure white lotus flowers everywhere. These are overflowing with divine energy. In the center of Brahmalok is Brahmapura. Brahmapura is a huge palace in which Brahma lives in. Below Satyalok is Tapalok, and above it is the end of the material universe and the start of Vishnu's Vaikuntha. Kailash of Shiva. Lord Shiva lives on Mount Kailash, located in the northeastern side of Kubera's abode. Lord Shiva created Mount Kailash through the power of his austerities. Mount Kailash is a reflection of the original abode of Lord Shiva, called Anandavana Shivaloka, which is above the 14 realms of the material world. Lord Shiva sports with his wife Parvati on Mount Kailash, which is spread over a distance of 1 crore yojanas. Two important lakes are situated near Mount Kailash. Lake Mansarovar was created from the mind of Brahma, and Gauri Kunda is the sacred bathing place of goddess Parvati, where Ganesha was born. At the summit of Mount Kailash, Lord Shiva sits in meditation, accompanied by crores of his companions, the ghosts, and the other ganas, the goblins, the pishachas, and ganas. Where Lord Shiva sits in meditation, crores of cosmic eggs are created from the power of his meditation. Lord Shiva, the protector of the three worlds, dwells in Mount Kailash with goddess Parvati and his sons Ganesha and Kartikeya. Abode of Lord Vishnu. The abode of Lord Vishnu is known as Vaikuntha and constitutes of numerous janapadas, that is villages. As all abodes of gods, this too is made of rich materials like gold, crystals, precious stones and other ornamental materials. It is the most majestic place and its beauty is unparalleled, and it houses many grand palaces fully decorated with jewels and diamonds, each with a beautiful and well-tended garden. The central part of Vaikuntha is called Ayodhya, and being so important and opulent, it is protected by Dwarapalas named Chandra, Prachanda, Bhadra, Subhadra, Jaya, Vijaya, Pata and Vidhata. Vaikuntha is inhabited by countless divinities and Vishnu's ardent worshippers who live in the proximity of their Lord. there is happiness everywhere, happy beings living in well well illuminated splendid houses, divine music fills the air, the groves and orchards are always bearing fragrant flowers and fruits. So there is a belief that gods reside where there is abundance of nature, like water, good clear water, a lot of greenery, flowers and nice fragrances. So it's believed that gods reside there. And especially in Maharashtra, we have this concept of Devrai, which are forests which are dedicated to some deities, and no tree from there is even touched, or like no fruits are plucked. So it is believed that the deity who resides in that area, in that forest, uses all these whatever the products of that forest. So these Devrais are very sacred groves. There is a grand pavilion built at the center of Antapura, where Lord Vishnu has his throne. In the central part of Ayodhya is situated the Antapura of Lord Vishnu. This is the most picturesque part of Vaikuntha. The throne has an arrangement of royal throne-like seats, which are for the visiting deities as well as by the embodiments of all the Vedas, the Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda and Atharvaveda. So centrally is located Vishnu's throne, and around, surrounding his throne, are throne-like seats for the other deities. So that is for the, because of the mark of respect which Vishnu has for all the deities. There is a grand pedestal called Yagnesha established on the throne. A large blue lotus flower is located on the Yagneha, on which is seated Lord Vishnu with his consort Lakshmi. Now coming to the, from the gods we come to the Yakshas, and from, I have the description of the house of the Yaksha from Kalidasa's Meghdootam. A peep into the city palaces and the landscaping in the garden of the Yaksha. Alkapuri, the kingdom of Kuber, was situated at a greater height than Kailash Mountain. It is near the Mansarovar Lake, which is a dream destination for all birds. As the pinning Yaksha sitting on the Ramgiri Hill requests the Megha to be his messenger to his wife, who is in Alkapuri, Yaksha is describing the route for the Megha and how to find his house. Since the city is at a great height, the Yaksha advises the Megha to make a staircase road, which would be comfortable for the touch of the cloud's soft feet and take him to the city. So he wants the cloud. He has been banished from Alkapuri by Kubera, because there is another story related with this, that he was to pluck a certain number of lotus buds, which Kubera would offer to Lord Shiva every morning in prayer. And when, unfortunately, what happened, since Kubera found a honeybee in one of these, so he came to know that the bud was not a freshly plucked bud, but it had been plucked the previous night, because the flowers open and shut during the night time. And so, like, he punished the Yaksha and sent him away, and for a year's time. And in that duration of time, he is longing for his wife, and he's wondering how she is, because the Yaksha was newly married. So, like, he is thinking of his wife a lot, and he wants somebody to send her a message, to convey his message that he's fine and he'll be coming shortly. He describes the city, which has lofty palaces and was very beautiful. He speaks about the terraces of the palaces of other yakshas. These are tiled with precious stones in floral patterns. The houses have jewel lamps which shine with bright flames. He tells about how other clouds reach the high floors of the palaces and spoil the paintings with their water droplets. These damaged paintings then fall off through the windows as if in fear. So they tremble and they fall off. Since Alkapuri is at such a great height, it is even situated higher above Kailash. So there is a lot of wind there. And when the clouds reach this portion, this region, they shed the rain and they cause moisture all over, and the paintings are spoiled. And with the wind, the paintings sway and they fall off. And so that he describes as in a metaphoric manner, that they tremble and out of fear they jump out of the window. When he describes the landscape around his own house by saying, "It is to the north of the palace of Kubir, the lord of the beautiful rich Alkapuri. The Yaksha's house can be recognized even from a great distance, as it has a beautiful gateway, Gopura, which is so beautiful and colorful that it resembles the bow of Indra, the rainbow, which is the Indradhanusha or Indradhanu. From this gateway, a flight of stairs made from emerald slabs leads to a large artificially created pool, which is crowded with golden lotus flowers. And many swans too live in it. They are so happy here that though Mansarovar is nearby, and Mansarovar is such a beautiful place and it is a dream destination for all the birds, and they would love to be there. But these swans who are in the Yaksha's garden, they do not want to go, even though Mansarovar is so close by, because it is such a beautiful place that they don't want to miss the scene and leave it and go somewhere else, though it is even Mansarovar. On the banks of this pool is a beautiful hill made specially for sports and for the Yaksha and his wife for taking a walk. The peak of the hill is made from sapphires, and to make it more scenic are planted golden banana trees. This is the favorite place of his wife, because his wife likes to take a walk on this little hill, and it has a beautiful winding pathway also, and the trees lined around have nice flowers, and it's a nice scene. So like, she loves to walk around there, so that is why he says that it is her favorite spot, and probably he will the cloud will find her, the megha will find her over here. Nearby is a grove of madhavi flowers surrounded by kushavahas and a red Ashoka tree which is always in full bloom. In the center of this grove is a golden perch with a square crystal base set with jewels of various kinds. The emeralds in it glitter like new foliage. This perch is for his wife's pet peacock, who dances at the tinkling of her bangles. So whatever movements of her hands makes this tinkling sound, and the peacock starts dancing. The doors of his house have painted figures of lotus flowers and conch shells, that is shankars. So this is the description of the house of the Yaksha. Rather, the garden of the Yaksha's house. So from this we can imagine how beautiful his house must be. And this is mentioned in the Meghdutam of Kalidas. Description of the houses of Vasanta Sena and Vasavadatta in the Mrishakatikam of Shudraka. Vasanta Sena's house, as seen by Charudatta's friend Maitreya, who is sent to return a pearl necklace. The gate is decorated with garlands of flowers and has an ivory portal, the entrance, which is made from ivory. And as we read earlier about the fragrances, so there are beautifully made garlands which decorate the doorway. The door to the house is plated with gold and has diamonds set in it. There are in all 8 sections to the house. As one enters the first court, which has a row of high balconies that are the color of the moon, and from these balconies the entire Ujjain city can be viewed. The stairways are shining with gold and inlaid with gems. The windows shine like crystals with pearl strings decorations. The walls have pure white paint and are smoothly plastered. The second court has domestic animals and pets like a monkey and an elephant. From this we can imagine the size of the house. If it is inside a court, so how big this place must be. This leads to the third court, which has sitting arrangement with beautiful carved wooden seats and a gaming table which has a disc made from gems. There are ornamental brackets from the walls which hold beautiful painted pictures. The fourth court has drums and shambles and other musical instruments. The fifth court has a kitchen and the dining area. This again is very big. This leads to the sixth court, which has arches set with sapphires. Here goldsmiths are employed to make ornaments with pearl, emeralds, red corals and sapphires, etc. This speaks about the wealth which she possesses. And the seventh court, which has beautiful cages with birds in them, which are hung from the roof with the help of silver chains. There are thrones like sofas arranged for sitting in the eighth court. This leads to an orchard and a garden with many trees and plants with colorful flowers. Here there is a pond full of lotus flowers. The house is so beautiful that Maitreya comments that it is Indra's or Kubera's palace. So Vasant Sinha's house is so well designed and well decorated that it resembles the house of a god. It is that beautiful. There is a very little explanation about Charudatta's house in the entire of Nrishyakatika, but that is important from understanding the interior aspect of those days of ancient times. Charudatta describes his house, which is in bad condition because of his recent poverty. So Charudatta was a very famous merchant, and because of his benevolent nature and due to some other problems, he has faced extreme poverty and he cannot maintain his house. The masonry is so old and shaken that it barely holds the door awning. The painted wall is heavy with water and dissolved bits of mortar are falling. The doors are squeaking. This is the description given by a thief who is looking for a weak spot in the wall to break in. And with this, we come to the end of the session. Thank you.
So, thank you. Thanks a lot. And आज के सेशन में आपने द आर्किटेक्ट एंड हिज टीम, उसके बाद बाइंडिंग एंड वाटरप्रूफिंग मटेरियल्स, यूनिट्स ऑफ मेजरमेंट्स, एंट्रेंस डोर्स, डोर फ्रेम्स एंड विंडोज, सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ फ्रेग्रेंस एंड देयर यूज इन एंशिएंट इंडियन होम्स, गिल्ड्स एंड मैथोलॉजिकल अबोर्ड्स, जिसके बारे में आज आपने हमें बताया. ये बहुत अच्छा हमारे लिए जानकारी थी, क्योंकि इसमें जैसे कुछ लास्ट आपने ये एक वसंत सेना और इसका जो जिक्र आप केस में किया, तो ये बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट था, क्योंकि हम बाकी ऐसे नाट ड्रामा या लिटरेरी सोर्सेज जो है उसको पढ़ते हैं, बट ये द डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ द हाउस ऑफ वसंत सेना एंड वासुदत्ता, तो मृच्छकटिकम, तो मृच्छकटिक तो पढ़ा है इसके पहले भी, बट ये पता नहीं था कि इसमें इस तरह का वर्णन जो है ये आपने उसमें से किया है. और इसी तरह भूभूति का जो उत्तराम चरितम वगैरह जो भी बाकी ये है, ऐसा अगर हम ढूंढेंगे इस तरह से, तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है बहुत कुछ हमें प्राप्त हो सकता है. और इसके लिए ऑथेंटिसिटी, जैसे बहुत बार ऐसा होता है कि इसका ऑथेंटिसिटी क्या है, बिकॉज द बुक्स विच आर पब्लिश्ड तो पब्लिश बुक्स में ऑथेंटिसिटी है क्या? उसमें कुछ ऐसा कुछ मसाला डाल करके यानी कुछ अच्छा दिखाने के लिए वर्णन किया है, ऐसा हो सकता है क्या? बट हमारे पास जो मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट्स अवेलेबल है, सिक्स्थ सेवेंथ सेंचुरी से मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट्स हमारे पास अवेलेबल है, उसको देख करके या हमारे आर्कियोलॉजिकल एविडेंसेज जो है उसको देख करके, अभी आपने माइथोलॉजी के बारे में भले ये टॉपिक है बट फिर भी ऐसा लगता है कि इसे अगर हम मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट्स और हमारे आर्कियोलॉजिकल एविडेंसेस के साथ और भी ज्यादा डेप्थ में जाने के और अच्छी जानकारी हमें जरूर प्राप्त हो सकती है. दिस इज माय हम्बल सजेशन, बिकॉज मैं हमेशा हमारे एरा आर्कियोलॉजिकल सर्वे ऑफ इंडिया के जो रिपोर्ट्स है वो हमेशा पढ़ते रहता हूँ. एक्सकर्वेशन हुआ, इस तरह से ये प्राप्त हुआ वगैरह. हम नालंदा के बारे में, तक्षशिला के बारे में बहुत पढ़ते. विक्रमशिला यूनिवर्सिटी का इंटीरियर एंड आर्किटेक्चर स्टाइल जो है उसके बारे में अगर आप पढ़ेंगे और ज्यादा जानकारी आपको भी इसमें प्राप्त हो सकेगी. लाइक दैट अजंता पेंटिंग्स जो अपने आप में एक महागाथा है ये सभी के, बिकॉज 8 वॉल्यूम्स पब्लिश्ड, 4 वॉल्यूम्स पेंटिंग्स, उसको भी अगर ठीक से देखेंगे तो भी हमें बहुत सारे और रेफरेंसेस प्राप्त हो सकते. इसका मतलब मुझे ये कहना है कि हमारे पास एक एक ऐसी धरोहर है कि कैसे प्लेसेस है. भीमबेटका, इफ वी स्टडीड ओनली द भीमबेटका, तो एंसेंट से मॉडर्न तक हमें बहुत अच्छे इस तरह से यानी क्या यूज किया जाता था, किस तरह से. अब हम वारली पेंटिंग्स, एक मॉडर्न में वारली पेंटिंग्स का महाराष्ट्र का हमारे यहाँ का ट्रेडिशन, बट उस वारली पेंटिंग में वो लोग जो यूज कर रहे हैं यानी जो सिम्बॉल्स उसमें यूज कर रहे हैं, जो हमारे एंसेंट में हम लिटरेरी सोर्सेस में पढ़ते हैं, सो पटचित्र है इस तरह से, तो इसका मतलब इतने सारे सोर्सेस हमारे पास है, बट आपने जिस तरह से उसको नैरेट किया है वो करना बहुत आवश्यक है. नहीं तो हम एज अ स्टोरीज हम पढ़ लेते हैं, एज अ पेंटिंग्स हम देख लेते हैं क्या इंक यूज किया होगा वगैरह, हमारा अपना उसका एक एनालिसिस होता है. कंजर्वेशन प्रिजर्वेशन के हिसाब से हम म्यूजियम केस में देखते हैं हाउ टू बेस्ट डिस्प्ले दिस ऑल, इसको देखते हैं, बट फिर भी हम इसको इस तरह से यानी एक स्टडी पार्ट जो है, क्योंकि अलग अलग अंग हो सकते हैं तो उस हिसाब से उसको हमें देखना चाहिए. ये दृष्टि हमें आपके ये प्रेजेंटेशन है इसमें से प्राप्त हुई. यहाँ पर कुछ अगर सवाल हो तो मैं रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ, इफ देर आर एनी क्वेश्चंस देन मोस्ट वेलकम. आई एम वेरी सॉरी, मैं ही जो है बड़बड़ करने शुरू हो गया.
थैंक यू सर.
यस विक्रम जी, यस विक्रम सर, यू वांट टू आस्क एनीथिंग?
नमस्कार मैम. मैम मैं सर आपसे और मैम से रिक्वेस्ट है कि जितना कुछ आपने बताया अगर ये हम इसका डाटा शेयर कर देंगे इट वुड बी मच बेटर टू अस. क्यों? क्योंकि ये चीजें हमने आज तक नहीं पढ़ी हैं. जितना जैसे आपने भी बताया हमने वो सरसरी तौर पे ऊपर तौर पे पढ़ी और वही चीजें हम अपने बच्चों को आगे स्टूडेंट्स को बताते हैं कि ऐसा है वैसा है और वो भी एक अलग से इमेजिनेशन क्रिएट करते हैं. हमारी अलग से इमेजिनेशन है और एक ऐसी फर्दर इमेजिनेशन क्रिएट होती है जो शायद रियलिटी से बहुत ज्यादा भिन्न है. नो डाउट हम जो मापों की बात पुट फॉरवर्ड करते हैं, हम मापों की बात पुट फॉरवर्ड करते हैं या तो इंडस वैली स्टडी करते हैं और इंडस वैली के बाद सीधे हम शेषासुरी की बात करते हैं या सिकंदरी गर्ल्स की बात पुट फॉरवर्ड करते हैं. एशियन टाइम के किसी भी पर्टिकुलर माप के साथ हम बच्चों को डिस्कस नहीं करते हैं. कलर कोडिंग को हम फर्दर पेंटिंग के अलावा कभी बात नहीं पुट फॉरवर्ड करते हैं. मीन्स हम जो टीच कर रहे हैं हम खुद ब खुद एक पर्टिकुलर एरा को छुपाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं बिकॉज हमें खुद नहीं आता है. अगर आप हमको ये शेयर करेंगे तो हम आगे बच्चों को बता पाएंगे एंड आवर नेक्स्ट जनरेशन वुड बी एबल टू नो अबाउट द एशियन पास्ट इन अ बेटर मैनर.
यस, वी नीड टू डू दैट.
आप बात पुट फॉरवर्ड कर रहे थे वो यक्षा वाली स्टोरी की, भाई वो पुष्प गंधक की फर्दर फो, उसमें मेरे को पंचाक्षी मंत्र याद आया थोड़ा सा कि वो जिसमें वो है नागेंद्राय नागेंद्राय त्रिलोचनाय भस्कंबाय महेश्वराय, वो आई थिंक इसी से रिलेटेड है. जो फर्दर वो जब उनको पुष्प में जाना बंद किया गया तो ये फर्दर मंत्र पुट फॉरवर्ड किया गया था शिव के लिए. तो कहीं ना कहीं जो हमारा लिटरेचर है जो हमारा रिलीजन है आपस में इतना इंटरमिंगल्ड है. और इस आपके इन लेक्चर्स से मुझे ये पता चला कि मैं स्पेसिफिकली हिंदू होने के बावजूद भी आई न्यू वेरी 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 लिटल अबाउट ऑल दिस थिंग एंड आई वन शुड बी अशेम्ड ऑफ ऑल दिस बट थैंक्स अ लॉट मैम फॉर गाइडिंग फॉर ऑल दिस इंफॉर्मेशन.
Most welcome, sir.
It would be much better for us. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. बिकॉज वट आई फील इज लाइक यू नो आर पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, जो हमारा दृष्टिकोण होता है वो जो हमें पसंद है उसके हिसाब से बदलता है. जो चीजें हमें ज्यादा पसंद है वो ही दिखाई देती है, और जो पसंद नहीं है उसको हम नजरअंदाज कर देते हैं. सो लाइक आ पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, एंड लाइक आ पर्सपेक्टिव, आर लाइकिंग्स एंड डिसलाइकिंग्स यू नो हेल्प अस टू अंडरस्टैंड आर सराउंडिंग्स बेटर. So we have to be a little more open, I feel, and understand things in various with various angles. So that will help us, and like not just us, our future generations also. And knowing a part of art is very essential. Like sir always tells in his lectures that you know people, we should all have some develop and nurture some art, and that actually helps to de-stress. So it is another aspect of the same thing, like overall development of all of us.
Yes, thank you. Radhika ma'am, you want to ask anything? Radhika Chitreji.
Yes, first of all, thank you Suchita ma'am and Bhujang sir for this wonderful sessions.
Most welcome, ma'am.
Two things I wanted to actually ask. One is you mentioned a description about Kailas Parvat and Manas Sarovar and Gaurikund and all. But in the present, I have seen some videos where they have shown that with the deep inside the photos, there were caves on the Kailas Parvat and some metals were also found. Also, it is said that when you climb Kailas Parvat, your life also, the time, there is some time difference, I think I've heard. But in present day, whatever is mentioned, like Shivji sits over there, meditates and all. But in the present day, if you see from the physical point of view, we cannot see all these things. So how can we relate these to the stories which we have heard?
And like,
second thing which I have heard is, when I have read some stories and some people's experiences in metaphysical world experiences, the when the masters come and they deliver knowledge, all the whatever description about Vaikuntha and Shivalok and Brahmalok is mentioned, it matches the description which you mentioned just now. So this is it's a bit different. When I explain to my 19 years old son, and he asked me questions, I am not able to answer some of the questions. How to relate them? How to tell them ki Shiva really exists or these lokas are actually in existence? How to explain the younger generation?
Yes, that is a big task in front of us. More than a task, it is, I feel, a duty which we have to, like, you know, like considering the present times. Most, I would say, even our generations don't know much about all these aspects of life, because whatever our Western thinking has taught us to think in a different dimension and shun our own culture. I'm sorry to say if it is hurting to anybody, but this is my personal experience. And what I think is, like, you know, basically it is a combination of science and the various subtle aspects of life. So if we combine both these, like you mentioned about describing it or explaining it to your son, so if you, you know, try to devise a way of incorporating a bit of science, because now we have learned to think in a very scientific way. So scientific, considering the modern Western science, our sciences are, I would say, very superior. It's not just because I am an Indian and, like, you know, boasting about it, but there are a lot of references about all these things. So, and like,
but we must think about the new generations also, because hum agar kuch bhi karenge, agar hum kuch bhi likhenge, kuch bhi videos banayenge, anything, but if the new generation will not ready to accept it, then yes, our duty is that we must correlate these all things properly. और उसका scientific reason जो है वो भी हमें clear बताना होगा. अभी जैसे राधिका मैम ने एक time की बात की कि जैसे कैलाशा के ऊपर चढ़ने के वजह से life का और ये किया. Simple thing is that height and time, ये जो scientific इसमें जो है उसका correlate है. तो जैसे जैसे height ये बढ़ेगा तो टाइम जो है वो कम होगा, ऐसा उसका ये है। अभी ये किस तरह से कोरिलेट करता है, साइंटिफिक थ्योरीज क्या है, व्हेन आई वाज द स्टूडेंट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग आई वाज स्टडीड दिस ऑल दिस थिंग बिकॉज आई वांट टू स्टडी अबाउट माय प्रोजेक्ट रिगार्डिंग द सैटेलाइट लॉन्चिंग सिस्टम, मिसाइल गाइडेड लॉन्चिंग सिस्टम्स का मेरा एक प्रोजेक्ट था, उसमें मैंने ये स्टडी किया था। सेकेंड थिंग इज दैट कि अभी जैसे आपने कहा कि ये कैलाश या स्वर्ग ये एग्जैक्टली यही है, इसका दावा भी तो कोई नहीं कर सकता है, मगर इसके बारे में जो पढ़ा जाता है, जैसे हमारे शिव पुराण है या फिर और भी दूसरे, तो उसमें हम इसका जो वर्णन पढ़ते हैं, तो अभी दूसरी बात यहाँ पे फिर स्कॉलर्स में ही डिबेट्स है, नॉट टुडे, आज की बात छोड़ दीजिए, बट मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट्स को भी जब हम देखते हैं तो उसमें भी कई सारे डिबेट्स है। सो अपार्ट फ्रॉम दीज ऑल दिस थिंग्स, हमेशा इस बात को याद रखिए कि हमारे इन सभी चीजों से हमें जो बेस्ट है वो हमें एब्सॉर्ब करना है, न्यू जनरेशन को अगर देना है। अभी जैसे आपने ये मेटाफिजिक्स और इसकी बात की, तो हमें उसमें से क्या, यानी जैसे अच्छा अगर मैं सिंपल थिंग बताता हूँ हमेशा कि किसी भी मंदिर में जाइए, कहीं जाते हैं तो आप, या किसी गार्डन में जाइए, सिर्फ एक हाथ में एक कागज और एक पेन रख के उसको बोलिए कि बेटा ये सामने जो छोटा सा एक स्टैचू दिख रहा है क्या इसे निकाल सकते हो, एक गार्डन में एक अच्छा फूल दिख रहा है क्या उसे तुम निकाल सकते हो, एक बार वो उसमें अगर लग जाए तो ऑटोमेटिकली जो है वो बुराई के बारे में सोच नहीं सकता है। यानी ये उसके अंदर निर्माण होना, उस एनवायरनमेंट में वो चले जाए, वो थिंकिंग जो है उस तरह का होना, इसके लिए थोड़ी सी कोशिश ठीक से करनी पड़ती है। और इसीलिए और ज्यादा अच्छा, और ज्यादा अच्छा जब हम कहते हैं कि चमत्कार के सिवा नमस्कार नहीं है, तो तब जाकर के हमें ये सारे लिटरेरी सोर्सेज जो है कहीं ना कहीं यूजफुल होते हैं। आई यूज दिस ऑल दिस थिंग्स लाइक दिस वे ओनली, तो मैंने इस तरह से मेरे लाइफ में उसको यूज किया है फॉर द बेटरमेंट, कैसे हम कुछ अच्छा कर सकते हैं। अभी यहाँ मैं और दो बातें ये करता हूँ, जैसे भवभूति का उत्तराम चरितम मैंने कई बार पढ़ा था कि व्हाट इज द एग्जैक्ट लोकेशन ऑफ दिस भवभूति, उनका ओरिजिनेट कहाँ से था, इसके लिए मैंने ढूंढा दक्षिणापथ का ये कहाँ से है, और दक्षिणापथ के बारे में पूरा वर्णन पढ़ने के लिए राजा हल का गाथा सप्तशती कई बार पढ़ा, बट उस समय मैंने कभी भी इंटीरियर डिजाइन और इसके बारे में जो है सोचा ही नहीं था। अगर मैं सोचता तो शायद मुझे सिर्फ वो पढ़ने के लिए और ज्यादा समय लगता, मैं इधर उधर भटकने के लिए मेरे पास समय नहीं बचता। तो ये हमारी बात है, अलग अलग डिफरेंट पर्सपेक्टिव जो है उसको समझते हुए और उस अच्छाई को, यानी द बेस्ट द थिंग्स को एब्सॉर्ब करते हुए अगर हम बढ़ेंगे, तो मुझे लगता है ये हमारा सारा जो अभी हमने अध्ययन किया है ये और ज्यादा हमारे लिए यूजफुल हो सकता है। यहाँ sometimes science is explained in general storytelling methods and storytelling keep the story alive, सही बात है। इसमें जैसे moral stories के इसमें पंचतंत्र की कथाओं को वगैरह हम देखते हैं, तो हमें इन सबसे इतना समझना है, हम इंटीरियर डिजाइन एक हिस्सा है, हमारे 64 आर्ट में एक हिस्सा है, बट अदर ऑल आर्ट फॉर्म्स जो भी है हमारे पास, ये हम आने वाली जनरेशन को हमेशा ये बात, नॉट ओनली द न्यू जनरेशन, वी आल्सो, हम भी मॉर्निंग से लेकर नाइट तक ऐसा लगता है समय खत्म नहीं होना चाहिए, क्योंकि समय ही नहीं बस होता है काम करते करते, सुबह 6 बजे उठ करके बैठ जाते हैं तो 12 बजे भी काम खत्म नहीं होता, कभी कभी सुबह 6 बज जाते हैं काम चालू रहता है। तो इस वजह से ऐसा लगता है कि हमारी नेक्स्ट जनरेशन को बोलने से पहले हम अपने अंदर ये जो अच्छा, बहुत बहुत कुछ अच्छा है, वो अगर हम सीखने की कोशिश करेंगे, तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है न्यू जनरेशन को बोलने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगी तुम ये मत करो, उसको सिर्फ उल्टा ये करना है, हाँ चलो ठीक है क्या चाहिए और बोलो क्या, वो करता रहेगा, बेस्ट जो है वो करता रहेगा। हम उस अच्छाई की खोज में जो है निरंतर रहे, द ब्यूटी इज वॉट हियर इन ऑल आवर दिस लिटरेचर, द ब्यूटी इज वॉट हियर इन आवर नेचर ऑल्सो। सो कोशिश कीजिए कि ये हम अच्छा जो है उसको अब्सॉर्ब करते रहें। अगर मैं कुछ गलत पर्सपेक्टिव में बोला तो
व्हेन चिल्ड्रन आर स्कोल्डेड एंड सेड ऐसा मत करो, पर उसके पीछे रीजन क्या है, इफ वी गिव देम द वैलिड रीजन एंड दे अंडरस्टैंड यस दिस इज द रीजन व्हाई आई शुड नॉट बी डूइंग दिस, देन दे आल्सो अंडरस्टैंड, अदरवाइज दैट रेबेलियस नेचर इंक्रीजेस। and then children turn very defiant and then they go again. So like it is, if we explain in a nice way, anybody can understand. Actually, what before I started, like when I was in between designing this course, I spoke with one of my mythology teachers. Her name is Dr. Mrs. Sindhu Dange, Sindhu Sadashiv Dange, and she and her late husband, Mr. Sadashiv Ambadas Dange. He's also Dr. Dange. So, like, they were the ones who started this mythology course. And like in Mumbai University, which is a contemporary mythology course, and there are lots of books which they have written, and it's thanks to their books which has helped me to think in this different perspective. Like a lot of the I have read a book of Sirs, which is towards understanding Puranic myths, and like there are many books. I will, with Bhujang Sir's permission, I would like to put it on the group. If anybody wants to read as references, they are, we can say, the base for most of the mythology which we read now, especially because like it's like the our traditional languages are a little bit kept aside, and people prefer to read in English. So like these books are in English, and they are enormous, a big wealth for us to understand if you want to learn Indian mythology. So it's explained very well, and also thanks to Bhujang sir and for all the encouragement and the support which he has given. Thanks a lot, sir, and thank you to all the participants.
Thank you to you, and thank you all the participants. Yes, please.
Just one more question, please.
Yes, sure.
I have heard one more thing, that people have climbed and were successful in climbing Everest mountain, but they have not been successful enough, even of a lot of trying, to climb Kailas mountain. If you can put light on this.
This is like, you know, if you've heard about the Bermuda Triangle, there is some mystery about people, the vanishing thing. So it's like what like when you were speaking before also about Kailash, no? I just thought about that. I don't know what is the mystery or what is the energy aspect of Kailash. But then there is something which, or there are certain things which are kept to keep it a secret. Things people are discouraged. Could be like two aspects of it. It could be a religious thing also, that actually there is existence of Shiva over there. So God Shiva is living there, and it is the immense powers of our deities, which is cosmic energy, and it runs everything. So it's certain mysteries which we cannot really think about. Maybe it's beyond our human capacity. This is what I feel.
I want to add one thing. I think it is forbidden because it is a major important center for three religions. First is Hinduism, second is Buddhism, third is Jainism. And due to this particular region, I think this is forbidden by the world governments, I think, not to climb on that particular mountain. What I think, I'm not very sure about that, because still yet nobody have further even tried to climb that mountain. And it is not that much height as compared to other particular mountains. It is near about 6,000 meters, whereas Mount Everest is more than 8,800 meters. So due to religious significance is the most important thing, up to my knowledge.
Its height is also one reason, but ये भी याद रखिए कि हम जिसको जिस तरह से सोच रहे हैं, मैं हमेशा थोड़ा सा उसके अलग मैं शायद गलत हो सकता हूँ, क्योंकि हम जिसको सिर्फ शिव कह रहे हैं, इसे अलग दूसरा वर्ड भी यूज किया है, आदिनाथ। तो फिर अब आप जब आते हैं कि जैना में भी आदिनाथ है, फिर नाथ संप्रदाय में आदिनाथ है, तो आप किस शिव को मानते हैं, यहाँ से लेकर के बड़े ये हो सकते हैं। सो इसको याद रखिए हमेशा कि इन सभी सवालों में उलझने के बजाय हमने जैसे कहा सभी आर्ट फॉर्म, सभी लिटरेचर और सभी इसको अच्छा क्या हम सीख सकते हैं इससे सोचिए, ताकि ये जो है अननेसेसरी क्वेश्चन, हमारे इतिहास में सबसे बड़ी गलती अगर कुछ हुई है आज तक, तो तो हम सिर्फ तारीखों में फंसे हुए हैं. टिल टुडे वी ऑल द हिस्टोरियंस एंड ऑल द यूपीएससी एमपीएससी एग्जाम्स ऑल द कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जाम्स ऑल दिस वर्क्स, हम सभी लोग उसमें फंसे हुए तारीखों में. ये क्यों हुआ, लड़ाई क्यों हुई, इसके कारण क्या थे, उसके घटनाएं कैसे हुई, परिणाम कैसे हुए. उसी तरह से ये हमारा जो लिटरेरी सोर्सेस है, वेद उपनिषद जो भी है, इसमें हम इसी तरह से फंसे हुए हैं अभी भी कि ये ऐसे ही क्यों और उसका. बट हमको ये देखना है कि आज के वर्तमान में हम उसको कैसे बेस्ट इम्प्लीमेंट कर सकते हैं. अगर ये नहीं कर सकेंगे, इम्प्लीमेंट को छोड़ के बाकी सभी चीजों में बहुत लिखा जा रहा है, बहुत ध्यान है. इसी का कारण है कि हम हमारी जनरेशन को और नेक्स्ट जनरेशन को भी हम ब्लेम कर रहे हैं कि हमने कुछ नहीं सीखा, इतिहास से कुछ नहीं सीखा. वाई द रीजन इज ओनली दैट वी ऑल आर इन द ट्रैप ऑफ द अननेसेसरी क्वेश्चंस. हम लोग उसमें फंसे हैं. जो जो होना चाहिए, जो सीखना चाहिए, उसे हम कहीं परे है. सो जस्ट थिंक ओवर अबाउट दिस एंड इफ पॉसिबल इनकल्केट इन योर सेल्फ एंड इम्प्लीमेंट इन द न्यू जनरेशन. सो थैंक यू विद दिस ऑल. आई एम वेरी सॉरी इफ आई एम रॉन्ग, बट इन सभी बातों के साथ में सभी हमारे जो इतने पार्टिसिपेंट्स है सबका शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ. और यहाँ आपने 7 दिन तक हमें इतना अच्छा मार्गदर्शन किया, एक नया विजन आपने हमें दिया कि किस तरह से हम इन लिटरेरी सोर्सेस में और लिटरेरी सोर्सेज के साथ साथ आर्कियोलॉजिकल इसके भी आपने बहुत अच्छे दिखाए. हमारे कुछ एग्जाम्पल जैसे अपने पैलेसेस और इसके बारे में भी दिखाया. तो अभी हम कोशिश करेंगे कि हमारे बाकी सोर्सेज भी, मैनुस्क्रिप्ट्स, पटाचित्र एंड अदर थिंग्स आल्सो, उसमें भी हम इसको कैसे फाइंड आउट कर सकेंगे, इसके बारे में हम अध्ययन करते रहेंगे. और इसी शुभकामना के साथ मैं सभी को धन्यवाद देता हूँ और आपको भी शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ और हम यहाँ रुकते हैं.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Most welcome.